Unitarian Universalism is built on a bedrock of seven principles. And the two most important principles are: we subscribe to the notion that we believe in the inherent worth and dignity of every person, and also that all that is interconnected. These are the two most basic. And a third and final building block, if you will, is that we strive for justice in this world. One wag once said, "When I wake up in the morning, I am pulled by opposite impulses. One is to savor the world, and the other is to save it. This makes it rather difficult to plan the day." Most people of faith, whether they come from the common, from a more conservative tradition, or from a liberal tradition, will feel this tug of war within themselves. How do you celebrate community? How do you celebrate beauty? What is truth? What is authenticity? And they will try to seek a balance between that and how do we move ourselves and this world closer towards justice. Now, the notion that we are interconnected is actually very, very old. Ancient Greek philosophers sensed this, and some of the poets have pointed to this. One of my favorite poems on this topic is by John Donne from 1624. And to modernize the language a bit, "No one is an island entire of itself. Every person is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less. As well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thy friends or thine own were. Any person's death diminishes me, because I am involved in humankind. And therefore, never send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee." Often in our lives, we encounter many seasons. This particular faith tradition, Unitarian Universalism, recognized that there are good times and ill. Believe it or not, we actually do better when times are difficult. Some of you will recall that it was not that many decades ago when our congregations, and this congregation in particular, closed for the summer. We worked like gangbusters from late August until the first several weeks of June, and then there was a loud gasp, and people said, "We'll see you in September." And we would take off and make merry in the sun. And that was the great tradition of the liberal faith. And it harks back to the university schedule when the great universities like Harvard would dismiss for the summer, and the faculty, the students, the staff would disappear. And so the lonely sexton and minister would look at each other, lock the door, bid each other a happy summer, and go away. Because who needs church when all is well and good? Who needs church or spirituality when the sun is shining? In the liberal tradition, we bask in the sun. And we perhaps do not think so much about the interconnectedness and the dignity of each other, let alone saving the world when all there is to do is to savor it. We delight in beauty. We delight in truth. But lo and behold, this tradition was founded to serve people best when the going gets tough. When in your own personal life you stumble or struggle. When as a community there are barriers that seem to push back against progress, against spiritual growth. Things that seem to impede building all these connections. And yet that is when we excel as a faith tradition. That is when we need this tradition most. You may recall that Unitarian Universalism was the convergence of two different streams that had much in common, and they merged in 1961. Berkeley Moore is not here, but I will quickly mention that when he graduated from Harvard Divinity School, he was in the first class of individuals who had an option whether to be the last ordained Unitarian or Universalist, or the first ordained Unitarian Universalist. Berkeley Moore chose to be the last Unitarian minister. David Bumbaugh of Meadville Lombard chose to be the last Universalist. And everyone since has been known as a Unitarian Universalist, whether as clergy or as whether of a community. Now, when we come together, we prize many things. One of my favorite themes is building the beloved community. And we understand that beloved community is not something which comes easily. You don't mix powder and water and break a few eggs and mix it all together and put it in an oven. And 20 minutes later, voila. It is an ongoing process, often hidden. And that's the beauty of the reading that we shared. There are many connections which are made slowly, many of them hidden underground. And yet these are the ties that bind, that hold us together. And it comes to pass sometimes that we enter a period where the shadows are long, where the night seems to rise early, and we wander in search of friendship, of enlightenment, of each other. And we look for symbols, just like we look for light. Now, John Donne reminds us that we are social creatures. We do not stand alone. No individual ever did. But that we are part and parcel of a long lineage of our own families, but also of clans, and also of the communities which we choose and the communities which we covenant with. And we seek to recognize each other. There are many communities that work it simultaneously. There are communities that follow sports teams, and you shall know them by the color of their cap. There are football teams, and you shall know their fans by the color of their jersey. There are political teams, and you shall know them by their badges, whether they sport an elephant or a donkey. Throughout the ages, colors have been used. During the French Revolution, people wore colors, red, white, and blue, to indicate that they were in sympathy with the revolution. Likewise, during our own Civil War, patriots North and South created cockades and flowers to wear that mingled together secret hidden messages depending upon which flowers and how they were woven together, whether you were sympathetic with the cause of the South or of the North. And that leads us to the question of the safety pin. Many of us are aware that in recent months, starting in Europe, in England, the safety pin emerged as a simple symbol to show solidarity with the people who are disenfranchised, who are vulnerable, immigrants, people of color, people who seemed to be vulnerable in an era when there was a loud chorus demanding that we need to be segregated, that we need to drive out foreigners, that we need to be pure. But even before the safety pin became prominent during the post-Brexit days, we're reminded that there were other eras in which the safety pin represented safety of one form or another. During World War II, the Dutch resistance chose a safety pin as a symbol of solidarity with each other, that they were creating safe spaces, to use a modern phrase. And they would put a safety pin under their collar, and they could show each other this safety pin as a symbol that they were part of the resistance. Whereas other people sported Nazi swastikas, or in the East, the Soviet star, the safety pin was a very simple homegrown item, a household item, so that individuals could show that they were part of a resistance movement. Likewise, during the early 1980s, when the AIDS epidemic was sweeping the world, the safety pin became a symbol that the person wearing it practiced safe sex. Fast forward now to the 21st century, and the safety pin has reclaimed that notion that the person wearing it is publicly projecting the notion that they stand in solidarity with those who wish to create safe spaces for those who are marginalized, those who are vulnerable, those whom the rising political and religious rhetoric would seek to disenfranchise, to drive away, to condemn, and to exile. We find the safety pin in currency once again for a very good reason, because these are, to put it mildly, inhospitable times for large groups within our society, in our civilization. And so the safety pin is once again that important symbol. Now, almost immediately on social media, there was a backlash. A safety pin, seriously, that's the best you can do? In the face of all the issues which are flooding our consciousness, flooding social media, flooding the news, that's the best you can come up with, is show a safety pin? Is that all you're going to do? Is that all you were ever willing to do? Is your faith, when it's pushed on to take a stand online, is it simply merely a series of empty platitudes so that you can say, I stand with this group over here in solidarity, but don't test me too much? Many people, when the times are less pressing, will content themselves with simple symbols. Perhaps they will write an astonishingly well-crafted letter to the editor. Perhaps they will participate in a rally, a vigil, a march. But for at least the past 60 years, it's been very clear that when evil is rampant in our land, it takes more than the simple steps that so many people are comfortable with. I turn to a song that was popular in 1965, written by Barry McGuire, entitled The Eve of Destruction. One refrain says, yeah, my blood's so mad, feels like coagulating. I'm sitting here just contemplating. I can't twist the truth. It knows no regulation. Handful of senators don't pass legislation, and marches alone can't bring integration. When human respect is disintegrating, this whole crazy world is just too frustrating. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, you don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Which reminds us of another song, Everything Old is New Again. It would seem that we are caught, as Martin Luther King once said, in an inescapable grip of mutuality. Many of us who strive for a day in which we can savor beauty, savor truth, have illuminating conversations, enjoy the theater, enjoy the arts, enjoy beauty in all of its different forms, in particular in nature, we might very well feel that we have been pulled forcefully from that pleasant world into something very awful, where we have to take more of a stand. And to those who would say that it is childish to only have a safety pin, I would counter with the question, where does a person begin? And is the expectation that every single person must do the same code of conduct and the same acts of resistance that a certain person subscribes is necessary? It doesn't seem to fit who we are as a people of faith. We know that religion is so much more than the sum of creeds. We have staked our very sense of meaning and the continuation of our tradition on that holy writ, that religion is more than the sum of creeds. Rather, it is the sum of our actions. But we do not ever say that all actions must be the same. We have not traded orthodoxy for orthopraxis. We believe that our collective actions, some great, some small, are moving us forward as a religious community, as a community larger than this particular one, as a civilization towards something bigger and better. They used to say over 150 years ago, progress, onward and upward forever. Now we have been chastened and we understand that progress is not always built upon itself and that it is not inevitable that good men, women, and children will always triumph, or even that the better idea will always triumph. We know better. We have been chastened time and time again as individuals and as a people. But we understand that we are called to serve this vision of a world made fair, that we are called to build upon acts of goodness, to connect with each other openly, as is appropriate, but also in times of darkness, in things, in small actions, which might seem oblivious to the larger world. In this day and age, when there are so many things coming to a head, apparently, people are very anxious, and they want to know where they stand and where other people stand, which is why these symbols are so very important. But it is an initial building block of connection building, of covenant building. Because we understand that just as we are interconnected and we are not solitary individuals adrift in this inhospitable universe, we understand that it's through our interrelatedness, through our interconnections, and the work to which we commit ourselves that we can achieve progress. Knock on wood. We believe that the work that we are called to do is ultimately justice, but that it takes many forms, but that the essential ingredients are openness, inclusiveness, being a safe person, creating a safe space for not only for the exchange of ideas, but so that we can affirm each person, each marginalized group, and welcome them. This is not new. Communities of faith have been struggling for decades, if not centuries, on how to create a safe space, how to take a stand creatively and constructively. Some of you will recall back 30, 40 years ago when various institutions, including this congregation, took a vote that we were going to be a nuclear-free zone. My theological school voted to be a nuclear-free zone. And on the one hand, I'm rather pleased to report that we never did allow a nuclear reactor. We never did allow the government to store nuclear weapons in our basement. The banners were certainly quite vivid. The vote was overwhelming. And yet, several decades later, when our theological school community was revisiting whether to extend that, we had to ask the hard question, did it actually accomplish anything? Or was it merely a public platitude? Is that where our work left off? It is so easy to put up a yard sign that says, Black Lives Matter. We are a nuclear-free zone. We are a sanctuary. It's a good thing to advertise. But what is our response when those signs are stolen? What are our response when people don't even acknowledge the existence of those signs or those safety pins anymore? What does our faith mean in those times? Are we guilty of self-assuring platitudes, of saying the right words at the right time and then moving on with our lives to seek to save the world? Or are we willing to take it the next step and, in the words of James Luther Adams, to build an authentic faith of connectedness, a faith which is grounded not in hopeless idealism or distraction, but in the authentic work that we are called as a faith community to do, to engage with the world, to stand tall, to walk with others, to build coalitions, to continue, of course, to have our symbols, our signs, but to live our faith so that it is examined, that it is not something that we take for granted, not something that we can shrug off, but that it is something we walk with and that we refine with us every day of our lives, every day that we are in mutuality with each other. My daughter, when she found out about the safety pins, was very happy about this, and she immediately found one and put it on. Other students in her high school did so as well. Younger people did as well. What I say to her is what I say to myself, and by inference, you can listen into our conversation and see if it applies to you. Let's begin with that. Know the history of the safety pin. Know its hidden meanings. Reclaim it as a living symbol for this era, but know that it's more than just something which we can put on like a robe, like a stole. It's something, if we're going to commit ourselves to this, it's more than just words. Words are like creeds. You say them, they disappear. It is our actions by which we are known, our actions by which we are defined. Let us begin, but let us be real. Let us be authentic, and let us move forward, not as isolated individuals blundering through the darkness, but as people who offer warmth and illumination to each other, but also to those who so desperately need it in the days and seasons ahead. So may it be. Blessed be. Amen. My colleague, Laura Lynn Bellamy, wrote these words. If here you have found freedom, take it with you into the world. If you have found comfort, go and share it with others. If you have dreamed dreams, help one another that they may come true. If you have known justice, give some back to a bruised and hurting world. Go in peace. Go in peace.